Today we continue in our 40 days of community. And one of the things that I am thrilled about is that we have had over 100 people commit to small groups. And what small group involvement really is all about. And even though we have been tremendously challenged with everything from port to weather, our small group and our small group reports are still coming in as very positive. It's an experience that we're undertaking in our 40 days of community, recognizing that God created us to have a faith that can only be lived out in community when we are living it out with one another. And our key verse, one of our key verses for this, is found in Romans chapter 12, verse 5, where we read, Christ makes us one body and individuals who are connected to each other. Would you read that with me? Christ makes us one body and individuals who are connected with each other. So this morning what I want us to do is going to be a very simple message. We're going to look at four things that destroy relationships and four things that build relationships. And we're going to recognize that God intended us to be connected. God intended us to have relationships with one another. The challenge is, and how many of you know this to be true, relationships are difficult to maintain. Even the best of relationships sometimes go south. And so what we want to look at is some of the things that challenge our relationships and some of the things that we can do to remedy those challenges. And the very first thing we want to look at this morning is one of the things that destroys relationships, the first thing, and perhaps the most important thing, is selfishness. Say selfishness.
Selfishness.
Selfishness destroys relationships. And if you're following along in your notes, that goes in that first line there. So write that in. Selfishness destroys relationships. One of the unique things about the Christian faith is that it is a call to live together in community. There are no such things as Lone Ranger Christians. When Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me, and we get this picture that we're the only ones carrying the cross, we can look back into a history and realize that we are one of many that have been called to follow Christ carrying the cross. And that we're called as a community, that we can't do it alone, because every once in a while we will stumble and fall and we need someone to help lift us up. Also, while we are carrying our own cross, we may be walking beside someone who stumbles and falls, and we are placed in their life to help them along. And so one of the most incredible calls and uniqueness factors in our Christianity is that it's something we cannot do alone. We weren't intended to live out our faith alone. You know, eternity is going to be a long time, and we're going to live with one another. We're going to celebrate one another in eternity. This is our practice run now. And yes, we live in a fallen world. We live in a broken world. Sometimes we jokingly say, you know, I love the world. It's people I can't deal with. You know, that's a fact. I mean, just when we feel like we've got overcome that one negative relationship, then somebody else moves into our life and they come with that gift I call EGR, extra grace required. Does anyone have any extra grace required people in their lives? If not, you'll have some. On the other hand, if not, you might be one. So I don't know. But selfishness destroys relationships when we focus upon ourselves. A couple of things that the Bible speaks to directly. James chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. What causes fights and quarrels? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You want something, but you don't get it. You know, whenever people talk about the Bible being something archaic, that sounds like Oprah right there, doesn't it? That sounds like the current counsel you would get from a psychiatrist. Just think of all the money you could save and give to the church if you would follow the counsel. I just threw that in. Mary Hall caught that. If you would follow the counsel of the Word. That's true. That is true in the long run. In fact, Proverbs 28:25 says, selfishness only causes trouble. So if we've got this problem and it's called selfishness, What is God's solution? Well, in this case, it would be just the opposite. Selflessness builds relationships. Say, selflessness builds relationships. Say that with me. Selflessness builds relationships. Philippians chapter 2, verse 4. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Philippian church and said, look out for one another's interest, not just for your own. So you're traveling along and you're traveling as a group and you're traveling as a family. You notice when somebody stumbles. You notice when somebody's weak. You notice when someone is ill and hurting, and you come alongside that person to help. In another place it says, comfort one another with the comfort that you have received from God. Because every one of us will face that time of need. Every one of us will be placed at a time where no matter how independent we are, no matter how strong we feel we are in our own strength, we each were designed to be connected, that we were designed to be part of a family. I do love the fact that we were able to sing We Are Family and sing it with a spiritual meaning this morning, because it's a celebration of a truth that we all feel, we all acknowledge, we all recognize. But sometimes we cloister it off and we put the sacred over here, we put the secular here, and sometimes we struggle in between. Listen, this is my Father's world. Amen. And to my listening ears, all nature sings around me, rings the music of the spheres. And that means all music. It's His world. It's His music. It's His song. So selflessness is when we learn to look out for one another's interest and not our own. In fact, Paul goes into deeper sense in the book of Galatians, in the letter to the church of Galatia, chapter 6, verse 8. We read this, the person who plants selfishness, ignoring the needs of others and ignoring God. Notice how he pairs those two. Ignoring the needs of others, and when you ignore the needs of others, and ignoring God. Did you ever think that by ignoring the needs of others, you're ignoring God? That's how serious being connected is really all about. What happens? You harvest a crop of weeds. All he'll have to show for his life is weeds. But the one who plants in response to God, letting God's Spirit do the growth work in him, harvests a crop of real life and eternal life. This is the secret of sowing and reaping. It's what I was raised on. The secret of seed faith. Recognizing that every day we are given the opportunity to give something of ourselves. And only that which we sow is that which will grow in our lives. In other words, if you're a person that needs love, you need to give love away. You need to plant it intentionally into someone else's life, into someone else's situation. And you will find, as you do that, as you plant that seed of love in someone else's life, or give that gift of love, that God somehow will come back and be not deceived. He's not mocked. Whatsoever we sow, that shall we reap. That's an eternal principle. Now, some people say, well, that's karma, right? I mean, you know, the truth of karma is what goes around comes around. And the world can accept karma, but that's more than karma. The reason it's the power of seed faith is that as Christians and as believers, the eternal principle is that of a seed. Now, when I take a seed and put it in the ground, if I take a kernel of corn and put it in the ground, when it comes forth, it doesn't just produce one kernel of corn, does it? It usually produces a corn stalk, and that one kernel will usually produce a stalk with an average of 2 ears of corn on the stalk. And on each ear of corn, there's an average of 300 kernels. Give or take a few. Yes, you can go back into the store and count them sometime. I did that one time. But imagine that. From that one seed, you have now 600 seeds. Now, it's easy. You can decide what to do with that. You can either eat that corn, and I love corn on the cob, or I might eat one ear, but I'll save one ear, and that one ear that I save, I'll plant those kernels for a harvest of future corn. We get into this mode of giving and receiving and looking. One of the things that there's someone here today that challenged, because she's a bundle of energy, and I won't mention Pam Cook by name, one of the things that we talked about, didn't we, Pam? She said, how do I find the time? And I said, it's where you intentionally have to plant and give of your time. And Lord knows, she racks up more time invested in this ministry and church than we care to talk about. And we say thank you for that.
Amen.
And it's much appreciated. We'll talk a little bit more later. But to realize that as we do that intentionally, that we have to trust God, even in the things of time management, that God will multiply it back. And when we fail to do that, we literally reap weeds. Galatians 5:16 says, live freely, animated and motivated by God's Spirit. Then you won't feed the compulsions of selfishness. Live freely, animated, motivated by God's Spirit. I love those kind of words. Then you won't feed the compulsions of selfishness. So, point number one is selfishness destroys relationships. Selflessness builds relationships. Point number two, what's the second thing that destroys relationships?
Pride.
Say pride.
Pride
destroys relationships. We're familiar with many of the Proverbs. There's several places in Scripture that it speaks especially to this. Pride leads to arguments. Proverbs 13:10, that's from the Living Bible. Proverbs 16:18, pride will destroy a person. A proud attitude leads to ruin. And in Proverbs 16:18, in the Message version of it, it says, first pride, then the crash, the bigger the ego, the harder the fall. The bigger the ego, the harder the fall. Pride comes before downfall. It's when we become so self-assured in our own abilities, in our own strength, in our own capabilities to live life, without acknowledging that we were created to be dependent upon God. That there is a privilege of coming before the Almighty and saying, God, I need you. I surrender my life afresh and anew. I want to be used by you, but I have to acknowledge my need for you first. And that's where pride, that self, wants to put itself on the throne. I remember one of the old methodologies when we would share in our witnessing tools. That it was a picture of a throne. And the picture was either ourselves are on the throne or we put Christ on the throne of our lives. And pride is what keeps us from putting God on the throne. Now, understand, pride is something that we don't fully acknowledge, even as Christians, even as believers. Sometimes we're challenged. Take a look at this video.
I am perfect. I know I am. I am perfect, because I give and give of myself, because I love without ceasing, because I am talented at everything, because I am good beyond all reason, because I am humble, yes, very humble, because when you look up perfect in the dictionary, you find a picture of me, and only a picture, because words can't even describe, and even a picture tries hard, but can never come close to the sheer majesty that I am. Ask me the problem, and I will figure it out, but don't beg to differ, because you probably should figure that because I'm the best, my way is the best possible way. I am structured to perform, my body carved, my abs of steel, and quite a good-looking face if I do say so myself. I don't drink or smoke. I don't choose to blemish this perfectly formed body with an imperfect substance. I don't submit to peer pressure either. I mean, what would be the point of listening to imperfect people? I don't hit back, I turn the other cheek. I don't steal, lie, or get jealous. I mean, what would I be jealous of? I am perfect. I don't judge. I know everyone's already below me. And I don't rely on friends or family. For they aren't perfect, and they always let me down, but I am perfect. Or am I? You see, I give because it makes it look good. And of course I love, but I love myself most of all. And I've been given talent, but I only use that talent to raise myself higher. And I'm a good person, because I was told being a good person makes more likable. And yes, I act humble. But it's just a show for others to see. I lie, I steal, I hit back, and I get jealous. Especially the people that know where they're going in life. For it's clear that I'm not perfect. Rather, when you look up imperfect in the dictionary, you see a scratch where I try to cover up the letters to my name. But here lies my problem. For so long, I've tried to be perfect. Thinking that the big man upstairs ought to tell me something for my great life. But this is not the case. For it's when I think I am perfect, it is when I think I deserve something, that my pride destroys my ability to be without sin. So if the only way to be perfect makes me worship myself, then where does that leave me? It leaves me with the ability to do nothing, absolutely nothing, and let grace do everything. All the things that I ever do mean nothing and do nothing. For the more I try, the more I raise myself and lower God. But the Father has given me a grace that bounds my selfish pride. So it's when He takes over. It's when I lower myself and raise Him. It's when I do absolutely nothing. It's when I'm wrapped in His grace, allowing Him to do everything, that the I am makes me perfect.
Interesting perspective, isn't it? He began with I am perfect at the very outset of his speech, but he brought it into clarity when he said it's because of the great I am that I find perfection. You know, the answer to pride destroying relationships is recognizing that it is humility that builds them. And to realize that we are all, and in the words of my friend Bill Warwick, a case for grace. That no matter how good we think we are, we still fall far short. Everybody, I believe, has a life verse or perhaps two or three scriptures that mean something special to them. For me, early on in my Christian walk and my days at Oral Roberts University, it came as 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10, where Paul is giving his pedigree. He's talking about how many things he had accomplished for God and how he had arrived at the place of serving God in great ways. And then he gets down to verse 10 in chapter 15. He says, but it's by the grace of God I am what I am. And his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, for I labored more than they all. And then he catches himself and he says the three most important words you could ever say. Yet not I. Say that with me. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. To recognize anything that we accomplish by God's sovereign power, it's His grace. Grace is not just that excuse. Grace is not just that covering for us. And grace is the real empowerment for success in our spiritual lives. Grace is that fortified fortress from which we operate because we recognize it's got to be all Him. It's got to be His accomplishment. And that's where we have to lower our own self-esteem. We have to lower our own selves to a place of humility. That's what builds relationships. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, we read, live in harmony, be sympathetic toward, love each other, have compassion, and be humble. And then in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 23 and 24, let the Spirit change your way of thinking and make you into a new person. Understand that this is a radical concept, and it goes against our human nature. Our human nature, we are taught to be independent. Our human nature is, and our culture teaches us to go for the gusto and to be all that you can be. And there's, in the right context, those are energetic and admirable admonitions, but they've got to be in the context of the greater picture and the recognition that true independence is total dependence upon God. That's the only time we'll know true independence. That's the only time to let the Spirit of God change our way of thinking and make us into a new person. Paul wrote to the Philippians these words, be humble and give more honor to others than to yourselves. Your attitude should be the same that Christ Jesus had. Though He was God, He did not demand and cling to His rights as God. Imagine the fact that Jesus Christ humbled Himself, and Paul says, even to the death on a cross. Death on a cross was the most despicable way that you could have died in Jesus' day. In fact, the Jewish tradition was, it was a curse to be crucified. It was a curse to die on a cross. And yet the very Son of God, who knew no sin, who was perfect in every way, allowed Himself to be crucified and to submit Himself to death on the cross so that He could call everyone who would follow Him, let Him take up your cross. and follow me. And that didn't mean a piece of jewelry. That meant picking up a torture device that would lead to your execution. To recognize that following Christ requires a sacrifice, following Christ requires a commitment, and when we do that, then we have something of value. You know, there are people today that just don't value their spirituality because there's no commitment there. There's no price being paid. Christianity becomes an option. Well, I'll go on Sunday if I don't have anything better to do, you know? And it becomes a luxury. And that's not true Christianity. True Christianity is recognizing that God poured himself into flesh, became a human being just like you and me. So much God, it was as if he were not man, and yet so much man, it was as if he were not God. And he lived, and he talked, and he healed, and he walked alongside us. But ultimately, he laid down his life for us, and he bid us to follow him and to take up our cross. And so true Christianity requires that kind of sacrifice and that kind of commitment. And the fact that it's got to be done by the Spirit, you know the problem with being crucified? You can't crucify yourself. You know, think about it. You could get one hand nailed in, you could get your feet nailed in, but who's going to nail the other hand? It's got to be something God does. It's got to be something done by the Spirit of God. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And that's the true hope of glory. And that's the goal of every believer. That we lay down our lives and take up his. Point number three. So what else destroys relationships? Insecurity. Say insecurity.
Insecurity.
Anyone insecure here this morning? Anyone too insecure to raise your hand? Okay. Caught you. Insecurity is a plague, and it appears that it is something that we deal with more popularly in our culture today. But in truth, it's been around for many years. Proverbs 29, verse 25 says, the fear of human opinion disables. The fear of human opinion disables. When you know something in your heart is the right thing to do, but you're afraid of what others will think, and that prevents you from doing it, it is that type of fear, that type of insecurity. It plagues every one of us. It's something that we talk about, our desire to be independent, but then when we want to act and follow God, there's an insecurity that comes in, that questions, that challenges, that goes to the very core issue of, is this the right thing to do? Is this the right step to take? And so insecurity is something we battle. And again, it's something that came even from the earliest portions of creation. You'll recall in the Genesis story, chapter 3, verse 10, God says to Adam, where are you? Because prior to this, God and Adam had walked and talked, had fellowship together. But once Adam took of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, he suddenly found himself naked. He suddenly hid himself, and he responds to God, I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. Well, when you just go back to the rational points of the story, he's naked all along. But it suddenly became a matter of, is it good, is it evil? Because he chose to know the good and the evil. Prior to that, he had only known good. Prior to that, the admonition was everything God had created was good. But man intentionally chose to bifurcate his thinking into good and evil. And from that moment, we began to die to God. We began to separate ourselves from a good God who, through his goodness, calls us back to him. So this is part of this insecurity factor that we still struggle with. So insecurity not only affects our relationship with God, but it affects our relationships with one another. When we're insecure, we are less than honest with each other. We're less than honest about our vulnerabilities. We're less than honest about our desires, our achievements, the things that we hope for, because we're insecure about sharing them with one another. We feel like, well, you know, what if I'm asking too much, or perhaps I'm asking too little. So insecurity is something that threatens our relationship and destroys it in the long run. What's the remedy to that? Love. Love. Say love.
Love.
You know, I hope everyone had a good Valentine's Day. Jeannie just said, oh, be quiet. Jeannie works in a florist shop. Can we pray for Jeannie? Show us your hands. I mean, there are marks all over her hands from the roses that have thorns, right? That's a part of the Valentine's Day not many of us realize or exposed to. But the remedy, the solution to the insecurity that destroys relationship is a love that builds them. And where does love come in to address this issue of insecurity? 1 John 4:18, the apostle writes, love has no fear, because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it shows that his love has not been perfected in us. One of the things that I'm absolutely convinced, and it's not original with me, I've heard others say it, and I probably can't say it quite as well as others who have stated it, but the thing that prevents us from sharing the gospel more fervently is not recognizing truly how much God loves us. Not truly recognizing and embracing the fact that God loves us unconditionally, that his grace has been poured out into our lives, that we are heirs and joint heirs with Christ, and he loves us so much. There's nothing we can do that can make God love us more. There's nothing we can do that makes God love us less. He loves us absolutely. And if we were absolutely convinced of that, it becomes good news that we share with others. And again, we just present our own case for grace. We present the fact that God loved me. If he can love me, he can love anyone. How about you? How about your life? Is there that dark place in your life that's insecure that you've held back from knowing God? 1 John, again, chapter 4, verses 15 and 17. All who proclaim that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them. If you've proclaimed Jesus is the Son of God, God is living in you right now. We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in him. God is love, and as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. Circle that grows part. Grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid. This is an ongoing process. It's not something that happens overnight. We don't come into Christ, all of a sudden all of our fears are gone. But it's something that as we grow in his love, we will find that love is casting out our fears and our insecurities are dealt with in a meaningful way. But it's an ongoing growth process. Number 4, what finally destroys relationships? Resentment. Say resentment destroys relationships. Job, the old patriarch Job, to worry yourself to death with resentment is a foolish, senseless thing to do. And the psalmist David said, since my heart was embittered and my soul deeply wounded, I was stupid and could not understand. How's that for frank talk? And yet, those are the Old Testament acknowledgments of the reality of what takes place when we allow resentment to build up in our lives. When we allow resentment, somebody has done something wrong to me. And so I resent that. And I'm angry at them. And I'm mad. And I'm going to steam. And I'm just going to fume over it. And I'm just going to have a pity party. And I'm going to be angry. And every time I think of them, I'm going to feel angry. And you know how much that hurts them? Not at all. In reality, it is you drinking the poison, thinking it's going to destroy them. When the truth of the matter is, you're taking it in, and it's destroying you. And when we allow resentment, it becomes, the Bible talks about it. Well, in fact, it says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15, look after each other, watch out that no bitterness takes root among you. That's what happens. Resentment takes root in us. And it springs up and causes deep trouble, hurting many in their spiritual lives. But the solution for resentment is forgiveness. Say forgiveness. Forgiveness builds relationships. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13, Paul writes these words. You must make allowance for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you So you must forgive others. And then in Titus, this is a particularly insightful scripture. Titus chapter 3, verses 3 through 7. Once our lives were full of resentment and envy, but then Christ saved us. Not because we were good enough to be saved, but because of his kindness and love. By washing away our sins and giving us the new joy of the indwelling Holy Spirit. All because of what Jesus our Savior did so that he could declare us good in God's eyes. The beauty of this is that Jesus forgave unilaterally. Say, Jesus forgave unilaterally. And so can I. And here's what I mean by this. If you miss everything else, it's just one little spiritual secret that needs to be revealed to the church and needs to be practiced by believers from now until Jesus returns. It is to recognize the power of unilateral forgiveness. There's a remarkable passage in Scripture that Jesus says, those sins that you forgive, I forgive. Those sins you don't forgive, I don't forgive. Now that sounds like an empowerment statement, but that's an awesome responsibility that comes with that power. But further than that, it recognizes the fact that you have the power to forgive anyone who has done you wrong, and I argue with you to tell me the benefit of unforgiveness in any case. How has unforgiveness ever benefited your life? How has unforgiveness ever strengthened your life? Ever enhanced your life? Ever ease the pressure of your life, holding something back. Whereas when you rise up and you say, because Christ lives in me and he forgave me by his mercy and by his grace, I can forgive you. You are empowered to be more than a conqueror over anything that has come against your life. And it is a forgiveness that is unilateral. And each one of us, even if we're the victims and objects of someone else's hurtful actions or words, we have the special power to release not only that other person, but in truth, release ourselves by the power of unilateral forgiveness. I want you to understand one other thing, and I'm going to close with an illustration here. The most important thing I can say to you right now is that if you go back and look at the New Testament, scour the pages of the four Gospels. No one ever asked Jesus for forgiveness. No one ever asked Jesus for forgiveness. They asked him for healing. They asked him for deliverance. They asked him to make more bread. But they never said, forgive me. But Jesus forgave unilaterally. He said, son, you're healed, and your sins are forgiven. He said from the cross to those that had crucified him, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. The power of unilateral forgiveness could transform this world, is transforming this world, and will ultimately transform this world when the people of God embrace that power and that choice in their lives. But on a person-to-person basis, it also has that power. Take a look at this video to close.
Covered by your love, covered.
Father, we open ourselves to you to do a new thing, a new work in our lives, to not only minister your grace, but to give us your love and your discernment, to recognize that we too can be ministers of the New Testament and offer grace and forgiveness, even as we have been shown grace and forgiveness by the Son of God. So help us in our walk this week to look for opportunities to build relationships, not destroy them. To show forgiveness where we've shown judgment and resentment. To do the things that Christ would have us do. To not only live the talk, but to truly walk the walk. And to recognize that in doing so, we please you. And we are transformed from glory to glory into the image of Christ. In whose name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Please remain standing.